Welcome to another episode of Real Deal Flicks. Today we'll be speaking to another good friend of mine, Alan, who will be discussing a movie that he holds very special to his heart, the 1987 film Planes, Trains and Automobiles. Welcome, dude.
Hey, thanks for having me.
So, dude, so we're having a talk about a movie that's obviously you're really passionate about, a movie that you really enjoy. Like, what is it about this movie that, I guess, that has been with you for so long? Because the movie, obviously, you enjoyed, you know, quite a bit when you were a younger man. Probably, what,
that's right,
when you were, yeah, 8 years old, 10 years old, maybe around there?
Look, if you had to ask me, like, you know, okay, like, when, what's your first memory of, like, seeing this film? I couldn't tell you the first time I ever saw this film. I just remember that I grew up on these kinds of movies. I just remember that from a very, very young age, both these kinds of actors, you know what I mean? Steve Martin was a big deal. John Candy was a big deal. At the time, I didn't know it, but a lot of these, like, were John Hughes films. That was all a big deal to me. And I don't remember which one was the first one. I don't remember what was, you know, what really, like, struck me as a genre or a, you know, style of film that I really enjoyed. But I just know that by the time I was old enough to have, like, in my memory, a back catalogue of films, it was these kinds of films that just were always there, you know, that helped probably, like, you know, shape my idea of what good sort of storyline, like how good storyline works, how really good easygoing comedy sort of like sits with people and can sit with you and can carry on, like, you know, in just sort of like, you know, the way it makes you feel and you know, that after effect of after, like the after movie effect, you know, post seeing it. And of all of them, I'd say Planes, Trains and Automobiles probably just sort of in my mind has always sort of encapsulated probably, like, in at least from my perspective, just the perfect storm of all those things, you know. So in terms of the overall storyline, in terms of how well the actors just pulled it off, in terms of how fantastic all the supporting actors, you know what I mean, all the little characters that we meet along the way.
Yeah, there's definitely a lot of recurring John Hughes actors in this movie.
I think a lot of John Hughes films do that thing where, like, it's this story where you just meet a lot of, like, random people along the way, you know. And I know, like, before this, there was like National Lampoon's Vacation, you know, and I think that's probably the one that, like, everyone remembers the most in terms of, like, you know, this family, like, you know, taking this long trip. And a lot of that movie was, like, all these little scenes of them, like, meeting up in, you know, in a weird place or a weird person or a strange character. And I think over time, like, you know, or even Christmas Vacation later, I mean, if you look at that movie, yeah, they're all in the one family, but it's like a series of scenes, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, sort of like, you know, yeah, all connected.
It's almost like a series of sketches.
Yeah. And somehow, even though they're in the one house, there's all these other random characters, you know,
yeah,
the neighbors, the boss, you know, like, you know, the cousin comes to visit. In my mind, this movie does it the best. And for two actors who I just absolutely adore, comedic actors who I absolutely adore, like, it's, I mean, I'm in absolute heaven when I watch it. Like, I don't know. It's one of those films that, you know, I'm not saying it should be everyone's favorite movie, but certainly in my eyes, like, in terms of my personal taste, I find it hard to, like, fault the film.
Yeah,
you know, it's like it was written for me. You know,
so obviously, you know, like, I've known you for a while now, and I know, like, I think one of the first things I knew about you is just, like, you know, like, you're a big fan of comedy, and obviously, you know, you're a big fan of 80s comedy at that time, because, you know, especially being kids in the 90s, you know, that was the kind of movies we would often watch, right? 80s comedies, yeah, that's what we'd see on TV.
Like, it's funny because, like, of all the things that I'm into, like, I can oftentimes, I'm a bit of a hoarder, yeah, I mean, you know that, Andrew,
yeah.
Like, I'm a bit of a hoarder, like, I love to keep things, I grow very sentimentally attached to objects, you know, and I can oftentimes find, like, this is, like, my first toy as a kid, or I've got, like, all my original plush dolls, my babyhood plush dolls, I've got them hidden away in a box somewhere, you know, my very first comic book, I know what that is, my very first watch, I've still got that piece, you know, like, all these little things. But you know, I've always been a fan of comedy. For some reason, I was never a huge stand-up comedy guy, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, I enjoy stand-up. I like stand-up.
So not really like Richard Pryor stand-up back in the 80s, you know? I mean, you prefer his movies more than his stand-up.
Actually, Richard Pryor is probably a bit of an exception to the rule because what I really love is a story. Yeah, so those really good storyteller comedians, like stand-ups, I love. Like Richard Pryor could tell you a story. Eddie Murphy could tell you a story. George Carlin could tell a story. Like, you know, and many, many more, obviously, you know. Yeah. Some of these guys really knew how to tell a story because I think that's what I connect with. I can't just connect with individual like
punchlines and jokes.
Punchlines and jokes, that's right, you know? Unless it's Mitch Hedberg, that guy's a genius.
Like wearing a turtleneck is like being strangled by a really weak guy. All damn day. Like if you wear a turtleneck and a backpack, it's like a weak midget trying to bring you down.
I need something that I can sort of, not necessarily like see myself in, but at least be caught up in the process of that story.
Yeah, of course.
And, you know, you'd remember this. I'll tell a story about a primary school teacher that you and I had, Mr. TV.
Sure, of course.
Mr. Tom Bartolotta, who in my mind was one of the greatest storytellers of all time. When he
especially in camp,
stuff to say, especially at camp, you know, I think he retold the monster at 30,000 feet, whatever it is.
That was the old Twilight. It was a Twilight Zone episode.
Was it Twilight Zone? Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. It was the original one, and then obviously I think they made the movie, and they redid that with I think the original one's with what's his name, William Shatner. And then,
yes,
and then
say, the Shatner.
Yeah, and then the one in the movie that I think was also done by John Landis. Because I think there were certain like clips in that movie. I think one of them was done by John Landis. But the one we're talking about, I think who's the guy from who's the guy from Third Rock of the Sun?
That's right.
And I remember, dude, I think that was like one of the like most scariest, like, you know, like clips for me.
Super tense, emotive, you know what I mean? Like it really enthralls you. It really, like a story, I mean, you know, now I'm just talking about stories, but like, you know,
it's important.
Part of storytelling. Yeah, it's that part of storytelling that I connect with, you know, because it's like, you know, you can... I mean, almost everyone loves eating, right? You know? Loves eating a great meal, whether it's like a hamburger or a great steak or whatever else. Now, if you took away, like, you think of the taste, right? Mm-hmm. But if you took away the look, if you took away the smell, like if you took away all these other things, you know what I mean? Maybe you're at a nice restaurant. Maybe you're like sitting on the couch, you know, in front of the TV with your family. Like, you know, who knows where it is. If you took away all those things, I'm not saying it would be like terrible, but like it would be like dramatically worse.
Have you been up all night eating cheese?
I think I'm blind.
Because yeah, you're eating great food, but the experience you're having with all your other senses like really helps set the stage for like...
It combines everything together, yeah.
That final taste, delicious, whatever it is. So when it comes to like telling a story, like... Sometimes I feel like, you know, some of my favorite movies are the ones where like the exposition is just right.
Yeah,
like,
gotcha, you know what I mean? Gotcha.
It's not like overdoing it where like, I don't need like this much information, you know?
Yeah.
And it's, you know, very visual, and it's visual, you know, visually telling me what's going on, you know?
I think visually is the most important thing. There's nothing worse than too much exposition when a certain actor's trying to tell you like, you know, the backstory or something. And you know, I mean, sometimes they're like visual, like, I mean, you have a, like movies are a visual medium, right? And I'll never forget, the best example is the Roger Rabbit. So Who Framed Roger Rabbit, when they're at that scene where I think, I forgot his name now, but, what's the actor's name?
Bob Hoskins.
Yes, that's right. His character. He goes to back to his office, and in that scene, you know, you see photos of his brother, you know, photos of them helping out Toons, And you know what I mean? They used to be like a joint detective. Like, it really tells a lot of story in just that one scene. And there's like zero dialogue in it. And, you know, and just with that 1 minute of just, again, all those visuals just tells you everything you need to know about this character. And then at the end, you know, I think, you know, he starts off with a bottle and then I think he goes to sleep. And then it's just like, it's the morning. Like, the transition is so seamless. And then sort of like the bottle's empty and it just tells you everything you need to know.
The opposite of this, the opposite of what we're talking about, which funnily enough, in the extreme, I also love. I love anime, but like it's a very Japanese style of that over exposition where, and you would know if you watch an episode of like a Dragon Ball Z, any anime, like they're just standing there talking about stuff. And it's not like they're talking about like actual, like it's a very literal. Well, this is how powerful I am, and because of this, and I've been training it. You know what I mean? It's like, I'm going to tell you this entire story. You know, they do a lot of that. Whereas, you know, maybe it's about finding the right balance, I suppose.
Yeah.
Or maybe just anime scratches a certain itch that, like, you know, if I then had that same thing happening in a movie, I wouldn't like it all. You know, this movie, from the get-go, the opening scene, it's like an almost silent scene.
We're
in the office. Mm-hmm. The boss is like looking at all the, you know, the marketing stuff. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And like Steve Martin is clearly like,
he's looking like, at his watch.
Know, wanting to rush, you know? Mm. And it even does this thing that I, you know, just completely forgot about where it like shows the ticket and then it kind of like shades out everything else. And
it really like highlights it. Yeah.
Yeah. The time. And he's telling his mate like, oh, you know, it's time. You know what I mean? And like already you just eat it, like you're in it with him. I mean, it's a visual movie, so they're a visual medium, you know.
And I think
certainly like script, like writing is very, very important, you know. Soundtracks and musical compositions are very, very important. Again, they help set that stage, but it's primarily a visual medium, right? You know,
100%.
And so that's how you're taking it all in, you know.
Cool. Obviously, you know, movies back then like mean very different to like movies now, right? We're adults, you know, we have more nuance, we understand things that we didn't understand when we were younger. So like how has this movie evolved throughout the years for you?
In my earliest years of watching this movie, like I think as the movie progressed, like I would like have a favorite character, but throughout the course of the one sitting, and I've, you know, watched the movie a number of times, but even still, like I would always like chop and change. Like John Candy's my favorite character. I was like, oh, nah, Steve Martin's my favorite character, you know? And I would kind of like enjoy the scenes depending on who's playing off who at the time. And it then dawns on me how much more relatable like they've become as I've been watching the movie throughout the year. It's like watching the movie Parenthood, like Steve Martin's Parenthood, like amazing.
That's a good example, because I know as a younger man, like a younger kid, I wasn't really that into it, but now as an adult, especially with a family, man, that's very relatable. So, you know, I enjoy it a lot more now.
I absolutely love that movie, and I think that was one that really grew on me. I've always loved that movie, but grew with me, because when I was young, I would relate to the kids, and then as I get older, like I'd relate more to the, you know, that the parents, to the adults.
Well, I think Neil, right? So you know, obviously he plays the straight man. You know what I mean? He plays the character that, you know, but you kind of like, you know, he's a family man caught up with his job. I think he's definitely very relatable, probably to most people. You know what I mean? You know, he's trying to just, you know, get through his day. You know, want to see his family after like a, you know, a long week of work. And then you got obviously Dale, you know, who's then John Candy's character, you know what I mean, who is, you know, like, I think this is what's really important about this movie. Like, unlike other movies, like Dale would normally be portrayed, like, I think very, very annoying, obnoxious, very frustrating. I think they tend to lean too much in annoying and it just becomes unlikable. But in this movie, like his character, John Candy's character, you know what I mean, he is, look, you know, you understand Steve Martin's character, why he's annoyed by John Candy's character, like you get it, but ultimately, you know, in the right condition, you could really hang out with, you know, with Dale, all right? You know, you could really say, you know what, like that's the kind of guy I would love to hang out with, go to a bar, so on and so forth. So, you know, again, but I think it just comes down to John Candy just having that extremely likability behind him. So even though he's trying to play a, you know, a doofus, annoying type character to Steve Martin's straight man, he can't help but just have that likability, which I think a lot of like other, you know, comedy duos, like they just miss that, you know what I mean? That annoying character goes too far, you know, and you just can't enjoy it, you know?
Yeah. Yep. I think one thing that's important to sort of like, point out is how good both these guys are at playing both those roles.
Yep.
Like Steve Martin is great when he's playing the straight man, and he's great when he's playing like the character, the eccentric, whatever.
He hates these cans.
Candy, like, if you watch Great Outdoors, and he is like every dad. You know what I mean? He's just like standard dad.
Give me 4 chili dogs and 2 plain dogs, please.
And 6 hot dogs, Dad.
It's for everybody, all right?
You know, but then you watch like this, you know, and he, or you know, or you watch like Uncle Buck, you know, you watch, like there's all these movies, and then he plays like the character, whatever else, you know.
I think his daughter said that like Uncle Buck was really kind of like his most like true to his personality. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like.
Yeah.
You ever hear of a tuna?
You ever hear of a ritual killing?
I think that was the one where he was like all in one. He was his own straight man. He was his own like character, you know?
Yeah.
And I think probably, like you're right. I think the way that role is portrayed these days, you know, it was not even a bad movie, but like not a bad movie at all. Robert Downey Jr. and Zach Galifianakis.
What's that? Due date or something like that?
Yeah, was that what it is?
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And that was all right, you know? Like, I remember that being all right, you know? I can't quite remember the whole thing, of course, you know?
But that definitely has a Planes, Trains, Automobiles feel to it, yeah.
It certainly does, you know? Mm-hmm. And Zach Galifianakis is amazing. But even then, like, there is some comedy in how annoying that guy is.
Yeah, like, know? Look, yeah, like, I think he's a great comedian, but he does go a bit too far sometimes, you know what I mean? I mean, look at the Hangover movies, you know? He went to a point where, like, you just wouldn't want to hang around with that guy, you know?
Yeah.
Shouldn't be here. Why is that, Alan? I'm not supposed to be within 200 feet of a school.
What?
Or Chuck E. Cheese.
Whereas I think what's really important, maybe this is the strength of, I think, certainly of John Candy, the charisma he has, you know, is just powerful. You know, like he just comes in and you just get that energy off him. That likability is through the roof. But also I think the writing is really, really important because there's not one scene. It's not like you go through this entire movie and there's like a redemption. Like, he's actually a nice guy at the very end, you know? Throughout that movie, like, throughout this movie, there are dots of, like, to and fro, where, like, yeah, he's really annoying, but then he reminds you how nice he is.
Yeah.
You know, it's not far into the film where the scene comes up where they really...
Yeah.
Sorry, go on.
Oh, no, just, but, yeah, like, I mean, the first introduction to... I mean, not other than the cab, where you just see his face and his shocked face.
Yeah.
The other scene in the airport where Steve Martin recognizes him... And it's instead of like just doing a flashback scene back to the cab, like most movies would do, they what they did is like they kind of like put him back into his jacket, his hat, and they put like the cab door, and had him still in the airport. And I just thought that was a really clever way. But anyway, but like just like when Steve Martin recognizes him,
I hailed a cab on Park Avenue this afternoon, and before I could get in it, you stole it.
Come to think of it, it was awful easy to get a cab during rush hour.
And then he feels guilty, and he's like, come on, let me buy you a drink. Let me buy you some food. So straight away, like, you know, like, he feels guilty.
How about a nice hot dog and a beer?
No, thanks.
Just a hot dog, then.
So, like, straight away, off the bat, it's like, yeah, he's a nice dude.
Even on the plane, he's like, hey, what are the odds of this kind of thing, you know? And at that point, you might be thinking, I'm thinking of like the biggest cynics out there who, I mean, at that point, they're like, this guy's annoying, this guy's annoying, this guy's annoying. By the time Steve Martin, and Steve Martin's one of the best at these, like there are a few actors who are just really good at just losing it, you know?
I really enjoy it. I think one was...
Tom Hanks.
Tom Hanks, 100%.
You know, end of Burbs, like Tom Hanks is just or classic.
Money Pit sometimes as well.
Ha 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 God, that's a great one. That's a great one. But Chase has his moments.
Yeah.
Cheap, lying, no good, rotten, four-flushing, low-life, snake-licking, dirt-eating, inbred, overstuffed, ignorant, blood-sucking, dog-kissing, brainless, dickless, hopeless, heartless, fat-ass, bug-eyed, stiff-legged, spotty-lipped, worm-headed sack of monkey shit he is. Hallelujah. Holy shit. Where's the Tylenol?
Definitely, definitely.
You know?
But the one I was thinking was Gene Wilder.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. There's, there's probably no one that can go from 0 to 100 and just have a look of complete and utter just disgust, shock, craze, mania, you know, like Gene Wilder can just absolutely like lose the plot.
You stupid, ignorant son of a bitch, dumb bastard! Jesus Christ, I've met some dumb bastards in my time, but you outdo them all. Get over there!
Straight away, when Steve Martin loses it, they're in the hotel room, and he's gotten all the way to the end of the night, and they're just wanting to go to sleep, and Del is like, you know, trying to clear his sinuses or whatever. And they have a bit of back and forth, but then Steve Martin goes well overboard. And it's at that point you realize like, oh, like the table is turned. He becomes less sympathetic because he goes too far. And then straight away, like Del, I like me.
My wife likes me. My customers like me. Because I'm the real article. What you see is what you get.
My customers like me. My wife likes me. You know?
Yeah, that's a great line.
I'm just a genuine guy. I'm just being myself, you know? And that just shuts Steve down. It just shuts Neil down in like a second.
Yeah.
And the entire movie is like dotted with moments like that, where it's like he never goes all bad, you know what I mean? Waiting for some finale moment where it's like, he was a nice guy all along kind of thing, you know? Well, he has those moments of like, yeah, I'm annoying, sympathetic, you know, and they cross over very well. They go from being like, hey, I got a late plane, and the relationship is very antagonistic. Well, not antagonistic, but, you know, there's a lot of frustration there.
Yeah.
But then, like, towards the end, the situations become huge. Like, the stuff they go through becomes more and more just insane. But they start, like, but their relationship, their friendship is getting closer and closer together.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So they got into the motel. Neil's managed to find himself a room. Del is stuck in the car outside because he didn't have the money for the room. And he asks Del to come in with him. Hey, you're gonna catch a cold. You're gonna freeze to death out here. But he brings him in, and that's when they really, I think, solidified their friendship. Probably they're drinking together.
Yeah, you know.
And he says a great line where he's like,
"I feel like I'm at summer camp."
Because to me, that's like, yeah, Steve Martin's character, Neil's saying that like I feel like how I used to feel, you know?
Yeah, feels alive again.
No thanks to the plane, many of us are still alive.
And the next morning when they try to get the car out, and the car is like fucked.
I mean, except for the radio.
However, the radio still works. Funny as that may seem, with all this mess, that the radio is the only thing that's really working good, and it's as clear as a bell. Don't ask me how.
It's like when I watched this the other day, it's almost like I'd forgotten that this happens. They reverse the car into the hotel. They completely and utterly destroy this hotel wall, and they're just like, let's get out of here. Get in. Let's get out of here. You know. Now they're in it together.
I think Steve Martin first, and he says that you know, like we work better if we're separate. Yeah. Dale gets kind of offended. You know what I mean? Because he realizes that he just doesn't want him around anymore. And then Steve Martin thinks he's going to do better without him. So, you know, but then he tries to rent a car. Obviously the car's gone, and then the whole journey back to the airport, and you know, we're talking about Steve Martin,
losing it.
I mean, that's a phenomenal scene. I mean, I don't think they ever curse in the movie, and they save all the cursing, you know, for that scene.
How may I help?
You can start by wiping that fucking dumbass smile off your rosy fucking cheeks.
He absolutely gives the lady at the front desk a serving. She does not have a bar of it, you know, it absolutely serves him right back.
Oh boy, what?
You're fucked.
He gets kicked out. He is undeterred in his just one. He's like this path of destruction. So he tells this guy off, cops a punch in his nose, and then Del like almost runs him over. And then he gets out. He's like,
now I'll move my car, but I want you to help him up. No!
And the guy's like, oh no! And he just goes, crunch grab.
I've never seen a guy get picked up by his testicles before.
And then when Steve Martin starts talking, like they've altered his voice.
Do you have any idea how glad I am I didn't kill you?
Do you have any idea how glad I'd be if you had?
Yeah. And it's funny you should say, you know, it's funny you should say about that scene in the airport where they leave him in the airport and put the car door in front of him. Like, there actually are a number of, like, things in this movie where they do kind of just break the fourth wall necessarily, but it gets a little bit meta where it's like, you know, the car door in the airport, his voice gets a little bit funny. Like, almost the entire scene on the highway where, like, they're gripping the car after the accident so hard that they're putting their fingers through the chair. when they're going through and Steve Martin looks to John Candy and he just turns around and he's a full, like devil, like, you know, with his laugh. And then they both turn in and then the skeletons, you know. Like, they have a bit of fun with it. So the movie is never like necessarily fantastic, like fantasy, but they don't mind having a little bit of fun in the way they're telling the story.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just, think, you know, this is going to be funny. You know what would be funny? If this happened, you know, or if suddenly you guys became skeletons, you know, they literally, you know, you're so scared that you guys are just like skeletons, you know?
Well, again, like, I mean, going back to visual, right? You know what I mean? You got to use, you know, the movie, you know, where you can. I mean, another good visual is always the, at the beginning, right? I mean, with his luggage, you know, Dale's luggage. So I think Steve Martin trips over it, you know, trying to get a cab. And then, as the cab leaves, you know, the luggage is also in the back of the taxi as well. So you kind of, you know, you have hints of, like, you know, like he's taken the cab and he's kind of prevented Steve Martin's character from getting to the airport on time, you know? Like little hints like that, you know. I think that's what.
When he trips on that case at the very, very beginning, like Del's name is on the case, but, you know, we spoke about this before. Like, you know, I don't rewatch a lot of movies. You know, I don't rewatch a lot of movies. Oftentimes, when I do, or I happen to like, I've seen a lot of movies a lot of times, but like, especially when it's a comedy. Like, I know the movie, I know it well, I'm watching it, and more often than not, like, it just puts, like, a smile on my face, and it just, like, it's, like, this enjoyable thing to watch, but very rarely do I, not rarely, that's, you know, that's probably an exaggeration, but it's not super common that I'm, like, laughing out loud, where, like, because I've seen it, I know it, you know, not that I don't find it funny, not that I'm not enjoying it, I am enjoying it, but it doesn't, like, make me laugh out loud. I'm watching it because I enjoy it, not because it makes me laugh necessarily, you know. This movie really makes me laugh.
Yeah, one of my favorites, I think Steve Martin's like asking, you know, like, oh, you know, what things do I do that bothers you, you know what I mean? It's like, come on, yeah, name one thing, you know.
You play with your balls a lot.
Yeah,
he goes silent, like, you know, I do not play with my balls. just nails him. And then at the end of that same scene, that same conversation, what does he say? Neil goes, you know what I need? And out of nowhere, like, snap, like,
yeah.
Got a couple balls and an extra set of fingers?
Kills me. He just nails him, bam, you know? Oh, man, I watched it with Michelle, with my wife, you know, for your throngs of fans, just introduced them to my wife. So I was watching it with Michelle, and it was first of all, the whole thing with the chair is hilarious, where he's like, don't play with it, you're gonna break it. He's like, you can't break these things. Then Neil gets in, of course, it's like broken, you know.
Yeah.
So he manages to go to sleep. And the first thing he does, he ditches the smoke, only for it to go back in the car. And they really sit on that on the payoff on that joke. They really sit on it because it's not until like the end of the entire car.
Well, dude, thing. That starts off in the beginning where when Neil tells him, "Don't forget that I put my wallet in your car." You know what I mean?
Yes.
Putting my wallet in the glove compartment. Don't let me forget it.
All right.
You know what I mean? Oh, no, actually, you know what? Even goes further back than that. It goes from like when he accidentally swaps the credit cards.
Correct. And it's not until like after halfway through the movie, I think they realize it's quite a ways in where these things are finally paying off. It culminates in this one huge joke, you know? But when he's trying to like, he's like, "Oh, it's hot in here." Mm-hmm. So he tries to get his parka off. And what happens? He gets one wrist caught, struggling, and it's really funny because John Candy is not only great with hitting a line, his timing is just like superb, but he can be very, very physical, you know, and like he's one of those big guys, you know, like, you know, I mean, he's not necessarily Chris, but like, you know, Chris Farley, for instance, you know, he's one of these guys who like their physicality, like they really know how to use it. And so he gets the other hand caught, of course. Mm-hmm. And this entire time you're thinking, what's happening with the cigarette? But now you've just forgotten about it, you know, because now you're watching this thing where he's like struggling and he's driving with his like thighs, you know.
But then you forget about it because
That's what I'm going to say. So you've completely forgotten about it. They almost crash. They get back on the highway, but they get back on obviously wrong way. Then there's this entire joke of them going the wrong way down the highway.
Yeah.
And it's not until after the truck, like, you know what I mean? Like how does he know where he's like, "You're going the wrong way."
He says we're going the wrong way. Oh, he's drunk. How would he know where we're going?
Okay, thank you. They're like making fun of him. And then that happens, and it's only then when they're outside, they've had the little accident, the car is wrecked, bam, the fire hits. And only for Neil to be like, "You finally did it to yourself." Well, actually, this thing that happened all the way back in the beginning of the movie, like, I'm just going to bring that up. And poor Neil gets wrecked again. But see how, after all that, he gets wrecked. He's now had this entire car destroyed and it's on his credit card. The next part is that same part we discussed earlier, where even though the antics have gotten so huge, the friendship has gotten so much stronger because, yeah, he gives him a punch in the gut. But then when they get to the hotel, that's when he says, like, "Yeah, come inside." And they had that moment where they the friendship is solidified, you know?
So obviously the whole ending, right? You know, you're finding out, Adele's wife had been dead for a while, you know? I mean, that whole train scene, I think, where Steve Martin, like, really kind of, like, figures it out in his head. I realized it was, like, such a natural progression on how a mind would work, like how you figure that out. Because I think, like, if I'm not mistaken, I think he's in the train, right? And he's he's really excited to kind of see, you know, it's been days, man, you know what I mean, since, you know, he's seen his wife, his kids. So he's seeing his kids, really, you know, kind of his two kids, or three of them actually. And then he has the image of, like, you know, Thanksgiving, and then his wife, and he's like, you know, then he starts thinking of intimate, but then he thinks of intimate and he goes back to, like, him and Dal in bed together, right?
Yeah.
You know, with the whole, you know, "Hey, that's not two pillows."
"Where's your other hand?" "Between two pillows." "Those aren't pillows."
And then he starts thinking about, like, you know, like how he's talking about how, you know, he loves his wife. And I think it was like a real natural. And then I think it goes to the bit where he's been on the road or hasn't been home for 2 years. I think it was such a natural, like, way, like a human mind would kind of get to that spot, right?
Knowing I was going to talk to you about it today, I kind of thought to, like, try to, like, pick up on as much stuff as I could as I'm watching this movie.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And the entire time I was watching it, I don't think Dell, like, referred to his wife in the past tense at all.
Mm.
So he, you know, like, he says, like, "My wife likes me," You know, like, I like me, my wife likes me. You know what I mean? Like, he never talks about her in the past tense.
My wife likes me.
Do you think almost like, you know, he has a bit of, like, denial? That's why he never went home? Like, he has that kind of, he can't accept it?
I don't think it's necessarily denial. I just think
maybe he can't accept the death, you know, of his wife.
No, I just think, like, it probably hurts too much.
Yeah,
And so his way of, you know, it's just avoidance. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's, I think he knows he's in a sad state because he has that moment where he's like, oh, look what you've done in the car. Look what you've done now, you know?
Yeah.
I am, without a doubt, the biggest pain in the butt that ever came down the pike. I meet someone whose company I really enjoy. What do? I go overboard. I smother the poor soul. I cause him more trouble than he has a right to.
I found someone I really enjoy hanging out with, and I ruined it. You know what I mean? Like, he knows. He knows the state that he's in, you know?
Yeah.
I just think he doesn't know how to deal with the pain that he's going. Mm. And he's, like, ultimately, you know, obviously her death has left a huge, like, gap in his life. Mm. And just, he's on the road 24/7. He's just, he's never not on the road. He's filled his life with work.
I think because his work is sales, right? So I think he just likes interacting with people, right? So just being around people. I think he just doesn't like being alone and by himself.
Yep.
I think that great line, man, which I think is a line that I think a lot of people, you know, probably should, take on a little bit.
Like your work, love your wife.
I really, really like that line, you know, because I think it's, I think some people do, you know, maybe not us, but I think some people do definitely take their jobs, you know, to an extreme, you know what I mean? Where I think they, and I think that's what's good about this movie, right? I think Steve Martin, like, is a career-driven dude, right? But I think, you know, going through that journey, he gets home and he realizes the importance of people, you know?
He never comes across as, like, an absentee dad or anything.
No, definitely not.
He never comes across as, like, so that's why, but he just comes off a bit cold, a bit sort of brusque, you know what I mean? And a bit sort of, like, standoffish, closed, you know? He clearly loves his family. He loves, you know, his wife, his parents, his kids, the whole lot, you know? Like, he's always calling them, you know what I mean? He's always calling them to let them know, you know, something else is fucked up.
I think when the flight gets diverted, right, to Kansas, I think it is.
Yeah.
I think that's the first thing he does. He calls his wife, right?
As soon as we got off the plane, you called home, I called the Braidwood Inn.
Where Dale, you know, calls, you know, for a hotel.
This movie, as a modern movie, the Dale character, the point of him is, like, you can't judge a book by its cover. And the point of a Neil Page character in a modern movie is, like, he has a lesson to learn.
Yeah.
In this movie, you never have to worry about don't judge a book by its cover, because he says it himself. He is how he is from the beginning.
Because I'm the real article. What you see is what you get.
He's an open book.
Yeah.
The Neil character, he's never not likable necessarily. Like, there's no lesson for him to learn. Yeah, maybe he appreciates his family more and all this, but, like, he's never a bad, he never doesn't appreciate them to begin with.
Yeah.
Even his appreciation might grow. He's very grateful to have gotten home finally, but he never sounds like he's, like, someone who needs to, like, he never takes his family for granted.
No.
So he doesn't have to learn, but compare that to a modern version of this movie, and that's, I'm telling you, that's how it would be written. It's like, no, he has a lesson to learn, and the John Candy character is someone who can't possibly be likable, but you kind of, because of the can't judge a book by its cover, you end up almost having to like him, because the story is telling you to like him. But I mean, you know, watch a movie. You know, I don't want to name any movies because I don't, like, you know, shit on anything modern, you know, because I love modern movies, you know.
Of course.
But, you know, this movie is letting you come to that conclusion naturally. It's maybe just trusting the audience to, like, yep,
yeah,
you know, we know you're going to get there. Whereas, you know, later on, they kind of got to tell you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, he's a nice guy. You know, you should be liking this character, you know. You should not be liking this character.
One thing I did notice was, I don't know if you noticed that it was on the truck scene. You know, when he gets the truck and he tells Neil, you know, he doesn't like people being in the front of the truck. The
driver's a little freaky about people riding up in his cab.
And I didn't realize he has a black eye. in that scene.
I never sort of linked it to that, you know? Yeah. And if that's the case, that's really, really funny. That's really, really funny.
I decided just to go all the way to the end credits. And yeah, and like, and the old man is still looking at which photo. Yeah.
And then, like, he's got the whole turkey on his desk.
But the side characters, the guy, what's his name? The guy who announces the cancellation of the plane.
Bueller.
Mate, like, that guy's awesome. And in the mask and, he's grinning at the end when he gives the bad announcement. And he just gives a grin at the end. Cause he's just probably so used to just giving that fake grin, you know? Yeah. And, and who else? Like, even,
one of my favorites is I forget the guy's name, but the guy who swaps the cards around, his son comes to pick them up, to take them to the other train station. And he's like, that's not his son, is it? I hope not. Like, they're both like worried that this guy is their lid. And he shakes Del's hand. Then he spits, wipes his face, and then shakes Neil's hand.
Yeah, yeah.
He just nails it, you know. But the taxi driver that takes him. That one time.
It's got all the trinkets and it's got like pictures of naked ladies and stuff, you know, all over the all over his cab.
You know, every the Optimus his character, like Dale's like, you know, hey, you know, he loves this town. Like he's clearly just taking him the long way just to charge him more, you know.
I know, but he's proud of his town. You know, that's a damn rare thing these days.
He really loves his town, you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So good.
I think the police officer, you know, I mean, who's saying, is this roadworthy?
Like he's in like Spinal Tap.
I do not for one think that the problem was that the band was down. I think that the problem may have been that there was a Stonehenge monument on the stage that was in danger of being crushed by a dwarf. All right? That tended to understate the hugeness of the object.
Mate, look, honestly, I think the only gripe, that I have about this movie, it's probably not really a gripe, but it's just, mate, like watching a movie like this, you know, I mean, that's set in the snow and it's winter and, you know, and then we're currently going through a heat wave. It's just, mate, it's just hard to watch.
It's too hot today.
So, Al, look, thanks so much for, giving us your time and, like, going through this movie that you enjoy so much. I know it means a lot to you, and it means a lot to me having you, you know, actually talk about this film. So, thanks a lot, dude.
Thanks for listening to us ramble on. I hope to see you all in the next episode. Take care, and good journey.
Say good journey.